Good morning, Community Church Deal. And if you're watching and you're not from Community Church Deal, good morning to you as well. It's an honor and a privilege to be before you this morning. My name is Nick Gilchrist, and it's the day of the Lord. It's the day the Lord has made. And the word says that we should rejoice and be glad in it. We've got an awesome service for you this morning. But with all things, let's just start the service with prayer. Father, we just thank you this morning that you are Lord. You've risen from the dead and you are Lord. And you're seated far above powers and principalities, seated at the right hand of the Father. And you're making intercession for every single one of us this morning. Father, we just invite your presence into our homes and everywhere we are this morning. And we say, have your way. Lord, we pray for those who may be unwell and sick. We know that you're a healer and that by your stripes they're healed. We speak healing now in the name of Jesus. And we just pray for peace that surpasses all understanding will now take over our hearts and our minds. We pray this in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. As I said, we've got a great service for you today. Gonna hear from our lead pastor, Pastor Jess, who's gonna lead us in worship in a few moments. And then after, we've got Luke coming with an awesome word from the book of Luke, actually. We've got all the Lukes this morning, from Luke 3, talking about the harvest and our identity and bearing fruit and letting God do what he said he would do. So that's coming up. But I also have a word of encouragement for you from the book of Luke in chapter 1. And in this, we see the story of when the angel Gabriel came to Mary and said, you know, blessed are you amongst women and you're going to have the Son of God, etc., etc. But what I focused on was when he said your cousin in Luke 1:36, he says your cousin Elizabeth is now 6 months pregnant. She who was called barren. And if you remember Community Church, the Lord has spoken to us about being in a womb of conception. We're getting ready to give birth to something new, something wonderful. And for some of us, you know, times before we may have been called barren, or you know, we may have miscarried. I'm talking about the spiritual things. But this time God says you're going to bring forth, and it's going to come forth speedily. And Elizabeth, who was old in age, who was called barren, was pregnant, and in her 6 months with John the Baptist. And then in 37 it says, and in the King James Version it says, with God nothing shall be impossible. But the NIV version, and I was meditating on this word this morning, the NIV talks and says, the word of God will never fail. The word of God will never fail. So I want to encourage you this morning that it's the word of God that has the power. And if God has promised us something, Community Church Deal, he is able to bring it to pass. I admonish you this morning, let God be God in your life. If he said it, then he will do it. Numbers 23 says that I am not a God that I should lie. If I've said it, I will bring it to pass. I will manifest that which I said. So take courage this morning. Enjoy the service. We're going to be having a communion service as well. So if you want to get your bread and your crackers or and your juice, your grape juice, whatever you have, to take communion, to share in the Lord's Supper this morning. So I'm going to hand over now to Pastor Jess, who's going to lead us in worship. May your hearts be ready to worship our Lord. And may we go into the deep place, into the courts, and then into the holies of holies of our God. Enjoy.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome. Bible says that we should come into his gates with thanksgiving, into his courts with praise. And that's what we're going to do this morning. We're going to start by singing, I will praise the mighty name of Jesus. Bible also says we should cast our burdens onto him because he cares for us. But that involves us literally casting our burdens, our cares, our worries onto him so that he can carry them. And that's what he wants to do. It's what he longs to do. Let's start. Let's sing. I will praise the mighty name of Jesus.
troubled soul. Why so weighed down? You were not made to bear this heavy load. Cast all your burdens upon the Lord. Jesus cares, he cares for you. Jesus cares, he cares for you. And all your worrying won't help you see it through. Cast all your burdens upon the Lord. Trust again in the power of his word. And I will praise the mighty name of Jesus. Why so upset when trials come? Are you so easily forget to cast your burdens upon the Lord? Jesus cares, he cares for you. Jesus cares, he cares for you. And all you worrying won't help you see it through. Cast all your burdens upon the Lord. Trust again in the power of his word. And I will praise the mighty name of Jesus.
Your faithfulness, your faithfulness.
dwelling place, your presence like a fire. Hope for tomorrow, strength for today. When shadows fall, you never change. From age to age, you never change. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. Through the years, you've always been there. Great is your love. Strong because our hope is in you. We will run, we will run, we will run. We belong, we belong, we belong to you, to you. We will stand, we will stand upon your promises. We are strong, we are strong because our hope. When shadows fall, you never change. From age to age, you never change. When shadows fall, you never change. From age to age, yes. How great your faithfulness. When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of glory died, my richest gain I count but loss, and poor content on all my pride. Forbid it, save in the death of Christ my God. All the vain things that my sacrifice, them to his blood. See from his head, his hands, his feet, sorrow.
Demands my soul. Demands.
surrounds my soul. My life, my own.
Thank you, Pastor Jess, for wonderful worship this morning. It's such an honor to enter into the presence of God. The Word of God says, in His presence there is the fullness of joy, and at His right hand there are pleasures forevermore. Lord, we love Your presence. We worship and adore You, and we thank You this morning. Okay, we're going to go into a time of communion now. So if you could grab your bread and your wine, and we're going to share in the Lord's Supper. And today's reading is taken from the book of Corinthians. So it's 1 Corinthians chapter 11, and I think we will read from 23. You ready? Let's go. For I have received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which He was betrayed, He took the bread. And when He had given thanks, He had broken the bread, and this is what He said. He said, take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Let's take and eat this bread. Thank you, Lord, for Your body that was broken for us. We receive wholeness and fullness. He's the bread of life, and therefore we receive our wholeness because He was broken. His body was broken. He was wounded for our transgressions, and therefore we receive healing and deliverance and fullness and wholeness because of the body of Jesus Christ. In the same manner, He took the cup. And after supper, He said, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Let's take of this cup. The blood of Jesus, the new covenant that gives us healing. There's life in the blood, so we receive life, deliverance, healing, forgiveness of our sins, cleansing of all unrighteousness. Let's drink. For as often as we, church, do this, we eat this bread and we drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until He comes. Thank you, Jesus, for doing it just for us, for you and for me. Thank you, Lord. We give you praise. We give you glory. We give you honor this morning. Amen. So we're going to hand over to Luke now, who's going to take us into the next phase of the service, the Word of God. Remember, the Word is so important. Remember the principle of the different hearts, stony heart, thorny heart, wayside heart, but heart of flesh is what we want this morning, that the word can come and be sown upon, and then the word can bring forth some 20, some 40, some 100-fold. We want fruit, the fruit of repentance, the fruit of works, the fruit of faith. So as Luke brings the word this morning, I pray that our ears will be opened to hear what the Spirit is saying. And I pray that word will be planted deep in our hearts. Remember, the word is as sharp as a two-edged sword, and it gets into the deep parts of our heart, the dividing asunder, the bones and the marrow. We pray for the power of the word in Luke's mouth this morning to take us to a place we've never been before, in Jesus' name. I give it over to Luke now. Thank you.
Hello, morning everybody. I hope this finds you all well and you're enjoying Sunday morning church from the comfort of your own home. It's different. I quite like not getting dressed for church, but you can see this morning I've made a bit of an effort. But I want to crack straight on this morning because I want to be honest with you. I feel a sense of urgency, and I feel that urgency is building. See, I believe it when we've heard Jez say prophetically that a harvest is coming. And I feel this acute sense of the reality behind the verses, such as in Matthew 9:37, when Jesus says to his disciples, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. I feel a sense of the need for us to prepare, the need for us to do. And I see in all of you gifts, and these gifts that could and should be used for the harvest, for our primary mission that's in Matthew 28 of going and making disciples. And I know that many of you are using these gifts, perhaps all of you are using those gifts better than I am in the process. But see, my heart burns for more. My passion, my desires are to see the more of his glory outpoured as we lovingly serve our Father and his kingdom. And this message this morning that I'm bringing to you, it's one that burns fiercely in my own heart. It's as fierce for me and what I need to do and how I need to respond as it is for anybody else. But yet I know that I don't always act in line with my own heart. But I'm my own harshest critic too. I work out and I judge myself, I criticise myself over what I do and what I don't do, where I do it and where I don't do it, where I do use my gifts, where I don't use my gifts enough. Sometimes I'm at risk of letting my weaknesses snuff out my strengths, and they can paralyse me into inaction. And I'm sure that you can relate too. And some of you watching this morning who know me really well will recognise some of what I'm saying in me. And others of you might be sitting there thinking, I haven't got a clue what he's talking about. And hopefully some of you would have been convinced that I have it all together and I'm doing all right. You'll look at me and think, what is he going on about? And you, of course, will have your own battles. Hopefully that what I'm saying already this morning is resonating with you. Even if your afflictions aren't exactly the same as my ones, we still have problems and struggles that can cause us to not use our strengths for God's will and for his glory. But you know, the truth is that I am doing all right. So we're doing all right. And the reasoning behind that is that my future's assured. I have and you have all we need in Jesus. He's given it to us already. And then aside from that, this idea of togetherness is just like a judgment on a scale. And that scale is both unique to you and it's determined by you. See, society plays a part in how we form these judgments. And we often have a tendency to use material possessions as an indicator of where we are on that scale. But in truth, like all of those other measures, material possessions, that they're no indicator. And neither is society an indicator of whether you've got it together or not. What you need, all you need, is what Paul was talking about 2 weeks ago, is that you need to know your identity in Christ. You need to know who you are in him. But how you view yourself, and through what lens, if you like, you view yourself, is a choice that you make. If you view yourself through a lens of, no, I'm not good enough, or I'm not doing enough, almost certainly you are viewing yourself from a lens that you have manufactured. And let me just say on this, we saw Thursday night, Nick was talking about spiritual warfare. And this really applies to all of these things. But one of the things he was talking about as we watched was what we say out of our mouth. Right, has a power and an ownership, and we need to confess the things that are of God and of true, because those are how we then step into those things. But the reverse has an impact as well. And so if you're continuously saying to yourself, and Nick's example was, if you're continuously saying to yourself that you're feeling sick, that you end up feeling more sick. It's the same here. If you end up saying you're not good enough, I'm not good enough, I'm not good enough, nobody cares about me, I'm not worthy, I'm never going to live up to that. What you profess out of your mouth ends up becoming a true thing when it's not, and that is certainly not what God is saying. And those lenses, and when I talk about that lens is something we manufacture on ourselves. we focus it, and we produce a thicker lens, if you like, when we profess it. And I say that we almost certainly are viewing ourselves through a lens that we've manufactured, because we know that inherently we're sinners. So for some of us, like, we know as sinners, it's easy to find ourselves doing things that are not good for us. We know what we do things sometimes that are against God. And in many cases, those things are close to or against the law, or are socially not acceptable. And it puts ourselves in a position of what we Christians call sinning, what God has determined sinning. And that's just not doing right by God, really. Deliberately, sometimes we do this, perhaps willfully. And then if we look at ourselves through those lenses, that, you know, we do need to change. We need to act. We need to do something. But I hasten to add to all of that, that I'm sure that when we look at that lens, even with sin in our life, even with something we need to correct, we embellish that lens. We embellish it with things like self-loathing, self-pity, you know the rest. Things need to change. They do in some of us. They need to stop, or they need to start. But even within those things, we allow ourselves to feel pity, don't we? We allow ourselves to condemn ourselves, to engage in negative self-talk. And they're lenses that we just apply to a situation, or we allow the enemy to apply to keep us down. And see, I think sometimes we allow the enemy to do it, and the enemy sneaks in and does that. But sometimes we allow the enemy to encourage us to do it too. And he just whispers in our ear, and I remember Paul's monkey on the shoulder at this point, whispers in our ear, and we just go and pick that lens up, and we put it in front of our faces, and we look in the mirror and we say, see, you're not worthy. And we talk worse about ourselves. But we know there is no condemnation in Christ, don't we? We know. Romans 8, it says, therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit who gives life has set you free. Free from the law of sin and death. We know we've been set free. We know we've been forgiven for the things we've done wrong. Ephesians 1, 7 says, in him we have redemption. That's in Jesus. We have been redeemed through his blood, through his death on a cross. The forgiveness of sins in accordance with the riches of God's grace. We know we're free, and we know we're loved. Perhaps the most famous Bible verse in John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son. And that world is you, it's me, it's the people that God loves, the things that he's created. But somehow we still find it easy to condemn ourselves. We can easily condemn ourselves for many, many reasons. And your reasons might be similar to mine, but we might also have very, very different reasons too. But the thing that I want to focus on today, and one of the things that I think we often condemn ourselves about, is the work that we do. Are we doing enough for God? Are we doing enough things? Should I do more? Can I do more? I should be doing more. And that negative self-talk starts to come. I can feel it already rising up. You're not doing this. You're not doing that. Do that. Do this. And then we condemn ourselves, we bring ourselves down. Now, if I had to title the message today, I'd title it with, do what you can. And it would be a real genuine, it's okay, do what you can. Because I think we should all do what we can. Nothing more and nothing less. But just do what you can. And as we start to do what we can, I suspect in many cases we find capacity to do more. We find it an ability as we start to do something, naturally we can start to do more. And experience also helps in that, as we've gained experience in one thing, so it becomes easier to do it. But we're not going to worry about that at all this morning. I don't want to think about growing our capacity. We're just going to focus on what we can do, because if we worry about doing more or not doing enough, it just leads us back to that place of condemnation. And we know there's no condemnation for us. When we're in Christ, nothing can stand against you. And if you need to stop now and just go and look in the mirror and say to yourself, I am in Christ, nothing can stand against me, then go and do that. Go and do that. Because I think as we go through, what happens is we understand who we are. We're grateful for our salvation. We accept our salvation. But we quickly and through time slide into a life of works. We can find ourselves wanting to do and then judging ourselves by whether we've done enough, by whether we're working hard enough, by whether we've read enough, by whether we know enough. And it ends up becoming, I have not worked hard enough. I don't deserve God. But that's not true. Ephesians 2, 8 to 9 says, for it is by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not from yourselves. It is a gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. It's not by works. Don't judge yourself and condemn yourself by that. It also goes on to say in verse 10, for we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God has prepared in advance for us to do. So it's not that we shouldn't work. We should do good work. And Nick and Jez again on Thursday night, they touched on that. Like if we're gifted with a gift of being a preacher, for example, that we can't just sit on our laurels and expect God to give it to us. We've got to work. We've got to study the Bible more. If you're gifted with the ability maybe to care for animals and become a vet, you can't just sit on your laurels and say, well, I'm good with animals. You've got to work. Right? So we should be doing good work, but it's not that that's the be-all and end-all. And I think it's just the worry for me, and certainly in my life I recognise it, is we have a tendency, especially when the chips are down and things are tough, that we can turn to works and we can judge ourselves by work, by what we've outputted and what we've done. And we can forget the good works bit. So in Matthew 6, and it's slightly different, but in Matthew 6, he says, right at the beginning, he says, be careful not to practice your good deeds. Slightly different to good works, but I think in the context, we can use it in the same thing, and we can interpret good deeds as good works. But if you look at the translation for the word good deeds, in some of the Bible translations, it changes, and good deeds is not there. Instead, it is righteousness. And they use righteousness instead of good deeds. And I think it helps us to think about that. So if we're to understand good works in the same context, what I think we can also understand that our works, in order to be good, need to be given to us by God. And we need to be in God. We need to remember that, especially when the chips are down, because as we do, when the chips are down and things get tough, what I think we do is we try and control, we try and push ourselves, we try and do to make things okay, and if we're not careful, we move away from God and we put ourselves into a fact of trying to control and do and work. And in preparation for this message, what I was drawn to some verses in Luke 3, and it's 7 to 14, and John here is talking to the crowds who are coming out to baptize them, and he speaks to them harshly. He says, you brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from coming wrath? Produce fruit in keeping with repentance. And do not begin to say to yourselves, we have Abraham as our father. For I tell you that out of these stones, God can raise up children for Abraham. The axe is already at the root of the trees, and every tree that does not produce good fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire. What should we do then? The crowd asked. John answered, anyone who has two shirts should share with the one who has none, and anyone who has food should do the same. Even tax collectors came to be baptized. Teacher, they asked, what should we do? Don't collect any more than you're required to, he told them. Then some soldiers asked him, and what should we do? He replied, don't extort money, and don't accuse people falsely. Be content with your pay. Now, they seem to have had, these people coming to John, seem to have had some sort of realisation. And lots of people did come to John and were baptised. They realised that what John was saying was true. And something about John's call really hit a chord with these people. And they didn't want to be thrown into the fire. And who could blame them? Who would want to be thrown into the fire? But I think as they're listening to John, they feel that fear, but they miss perhaps the most important game-changing point. And they start to panic and they take matters into their own hands. And in times of crisis, like I think we do the same. We have a tendency to do that. And you'll know over the last couple of weeks that my mum's been really poorly and you've been praying for her and we're really grateful for that. And she's been in hospital, but now she's home and she's slowly getting better. COVID-19's a terrible thing if it catches you badly. And we've seen some of the worst of it, but we've been really blessed by your prayers. And as a family, and mum will share with you herself, her testimony, she's really been strengthened by your prayer. And God has kept her from getting to the point of where it's been really, really bad. And we're grateful that she's now slowly coming better and better each day. But the hardest bit for me along all of this has been the inability for me to do anything apart from for prayer, which we could talk about for a long time now, because it's the most important thing we could do in time of crisis. But apart from prayer, and as my human tendency is to do something, to make it right, to help, but I couldn't. And so it's been really difficult. And I think it's the same with our salvation, with our identity in Christ. Sometimes I think it's hard for us to accept that it's just a free gift, there's nothing we can do. And it's the same in other areas of life when the chips are down. And I think we see in Luke 3 that the soldiers, the tax collectors, the people were worried about their salvation. They didn't want to be thrown into the fire, but they wanted to do something. And John told them what to do right at the beginning when he spoke to them, but they missed it. And so they asked him again, and then he told them other things. He told them, like, give it, those who have two shirts should give that one to someone that hasn't. And the same with food, right? Tax collectors shouldn't take more money. Soldiers shouldn't extort people, right? Those things are good things. And I'm not saying right now that we should not be doing those things. But what I am saying is, I don't think we can just have a list of things we should and shouldn't do. I don't think it's going to work like that. Some sort of holy to-do list. But as we journey with God, I think what happens is we dip in to our natural tendency of wanting to know what to do and creating lists of things. And somehow that might make us more holy if our to-do list is long and we've ticked off loads of things. Like, certainly I feel like that at times. But if that's you, if you resonate with that this morning, I want to say to you, stop. Stop. No amount of holy to-do list is actually going to make you right with God. You're already right with God. And I want to say that routines, they really help us. We might need to find areas of discipline in our life, structure, practical steps, they really, really help. Right? They're not bad, so long as our motivation is correct. And last week, if you were watching, Lindsay suggested some really useful resources that would help us. Now, I'm certainly not saying we should ignore those. Right, those things are important, they can be really helping. But what she also talked about was the transforming of our mind, the coming one with God. And what she talked about then as well was we should only really be moving when we hear God move. And that's what I'm saying. I'm saying the same thing. I'm saying in our lives that we need to ensure our motivation is correct. We need to make sure we're not just doing for some sake of doing, from some holy to-do list to go out and run and do, so that somehow makes us right with God. And I think that's exactly what John said in those verses in Luke, but they missed it. He says, produce fruit in keeping with repentance. That's what we should be doing. Producing fruit in keeping with repentance. And I get really, there's something boils up in me. I can feel it rising as a spirit of God. See, when we are repentant, it means that we're turning away from sin. It means that we're turning our back on it. We're saying no, and we talked about sin. But that repentance comes from an awe when we know who God is. When we love God. And so when it's works, they're just works, they're empty. fruit is produced from a very different place. When we work, we often toil, we fight hard for it, we have to graft. It has a real price on us. It costs us a lot. But fruit, on the other hand, doesn't really cost the same. Because the cost of the fruit is replenished by the Father. So when we're rooted in Him, we're replenished. He is the one that provides all of the needs to meet that we need to make that fruit. And Nick shared with us, some of us, a video the other day. And that guy was talking in that video about a similar thing. And he was pointing out, saying, look at a tree. If you imagine a tree now, how hard does it work to produce its fruit? See, what a tree does is it puts its roots down into the soil and there it stays. It gets all it needs from that soil. And the fruit is born out of that. There is little effort in the plant, in that tree, to make that fruit. That fruit comes from an outpouring of the goodness that it's got from the soil. And it should be the same with us. The cost of producing fruit is a life with its roots planted deep into our relationship with God. It doesn't mean that sometimes when the fruit that we're given and the fruit that we produce, it doesn't mean that there isn't a little bit of effort involved at times for us. It doesn't mean that sometimes we might not come in from the day having worked and produced this fruit for God and be tired of body. But our resources come from God, our replenishing comes from God, and we can know that He's got us. And the fruit and the motivation when it's fruit producing, the effort might still be on one side scientifically the same as work, but it doesn't feel like it because the replenishing comes from God. And so John says to the people that come, produce fruit in keeping with repentance. And it's that sitting at the Father's feet that gets me really feeling why fruit might come. Because when you sit with Him, when you spend time with Him, when you see the reality of what He's done for you, you can't help but burn with desire to see that in other people's lives. And then you want to do something about it. Only the cost is different, because it'll cost you far less to do than it will to do nothing. See, in this case, when you know what God's done for you and you're repentant of that and you sit in awe and you see that other people haven't got that gift, the cost of not doing something then becomes the cost that is too hard to bear. And when we do something, as I've already said, God meets our needs and we're replenished for that battle time and time again because our roots are in Him. And the impact of that is huge, isn't it? When we think about it and the impact, and we know that actually if we just continue to create our holy to-do list and work without dwelling in Him, actually our time and effort are hard fought for that, but the impact is less. Because let me tell you, if you give somebody the good works, the fruit you're producing that has come from God, they are replenished with God's love. And that impact of that has way more on them and on you than it does if you are just doing it of your own accord. It's life-changing. And so I genuinely believe that we need to stop working and start concentrating on our relationship with God and concentrating on producing fruit. Some of this fruit will undoubtedly look and be very, very similar to the works it replaces. It will. But the cost just won't be the same to us. And the impact won't be the same either. The cost will all but disappear as we're replenished by the Father. And the impact will just grow tenfold. Because it won't be you meeting a need anymore. It will be God meeting the need in others. And I love how God works. So as I was preparing this and I'm asking God what it is I should bring, things happen around me. And the Archbishop of Canterbury released a video on Facebook this week, and I was flicking through didn't even really have too much intention of watching it, dare I say. But he said, all right, he finds it himself easy to forget, but we live not by what we achieve, but by our relationship with God in Jesus Christ. And that's what I'm saying. That's what Paul was saying. That's what Lindsay was saying. There's a theme coming on. And it's that relationship that is the most important thing for us to focus on. And see, everything else will follow from that relationship. We can't help but want to do that. Let me just finish with this as an illustration, though. If you didn't already see it enough. So last week, again on Facebook, Cole Beach, you might know him, he's the president of Christian Vision for Men, as well as doing lots of other different areas of ministry. He posted this on his Facebook page and he said, one of the things that initially drew me to Christ was what I saw in those who knew him. Gracious, calm, not provoking hate or bitterness. There was a quiet confidence that did my head in, and assurance that whatever happened, all was well. I didn't hear the language of hate. They seemed to believe the best and give the benefit of doubt. If they did lose it, they were quick to apologise and seek forgiveness. It was a little chapel in Hornchurch, Essex. I saw Jesus in them and it felt otherworldly. I guess it was. I started to read the Bible and over 6 months I saw what I read was being lived out. It was an extraordinary time, and in part, it drew me to Christ and led me to do what I do now. I'm praying we are the same example now to those looking at the Christian community online as we interact and navigate in this unique time. See, one of the things that Carl credits for becoming a Christian has nothing to do with works, and it had way more to do with who we are. I put it to you that those things that Carl observed in the church should and are found in you. And they are found in our church. However, it's not by efforts of works that these things are there. They're born out of our relationship with the Father in heaven. No amount of effort or work can produce the peace or confidence that Carl talks of. That is time spent with the Father, being assured of his promises, that does that. See, no amount of work can manufacture love for others, love for our neighbours, love for our outcasts, love for the one who annoys you at work, etc., etc. That love comes from being in the presence of our God, who has an infectious love for others. No amount of work can manufacture grace and forgiveness for others. Nothing you can work at, create or build in your own steam will enable you to forgive those who hurt you most or offer grace when someone crosses you. It's your relationship with your Father in heaven. It's time spent at his feet, in his presence. It's his very nature that rubs off on you. So let that sink in this week. Our relationship with God is and should be the most important thing to us. It feeds us, it equips us, it forgives us. We cannot achieve it by works, but by relationship. And it's our relationship with him that is most attractive to others. It's our relationship with him that produces fruit. This fruit may at times look like works, but the cost to us is non-existent with fruit. And the impact of that fruit is beyond tenfold. So this week, why don't you check your roots? Fertilize the ground around the roots, around the top of that soil, with good things, with good people, with good reading. Go deeper into the Father's love and resources. Move when he says move and produce fruit. Produce good fruit. Let that fruit meet the needs of those around you. Do what you can. Nothing more, nothing less. Don't condemn yourself. Spend time with the Father. Let's pray. Oh, Father, I thank you that our salvation rests on you and you alone. It's your love for us and your sacrifice for us that provides our salvation. Help us, Lord, to give up works that are not of you. Help us to dig deeper into you. Help us, Lord, to fertilize that topsoil with good material, with surrounding ourselves with good men and women of God, of exposing ourselves to good things. Lord, and I pray that you would give us the resources to produce fruit. And Lord, I pray that you'd help us to be patient, Lord, because fruit takes time to grow. Help us not to rush ahead and trying to do it ourselves, but help us just to rest in your embrace and allow the fruit to produce from our relationship with you. And as we do that, Lord, would you allow us to see and to enjoy your glory, Lord, and the fruit that you have produced in us, Lord, would you allow us to see it meet the needs of those around us, Lord, in your name I pray that fruit would be well devoured by the world around us, and it would be life-saving, life-giving fruit. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you very much, everybody. Hope you enjoy the rest of the service. And I'll be around for coffee in the chat afterwards. Goodbye. God bless.
Thank you, Luke, for bringing the word so eloquently this morning. Thank you, Lord, for speaking to us, your church, this morning. And that we would know our identity in Christ. One of the things that we're going to be doing, excuse me, is in the next few weeks, Paul's going to be coming with a teaching and training on our identity in Christ. It's called Christ in Me. And this is going to really shape us, churches. It's who we are in him, our rights, our authority. And it's kind of all the stuff that we've been teaching on, even in the prayer sessions over the last few weeks. So that's going to be coming hopefully from next week and beyond. But there'll be more information about that. All right, we're going to hand over to Jess now for one last song. This is a group song. Really looking forward to seeing this one. I hope you enjoy it. It's called Tremble.
Shadows can't deny your name cannot be overcome. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, you silence fear. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, 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 your name is a light that the shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome. Life forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is a light that the shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is a life forever. Not be overcome. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, you silence fear. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus.
Oh, wasn't that wonderful? Thanks, guys. I wish I was a part of that. That was a really great group effort there. A beautiful song. Jesus makes the darkness tremble. Even as we call on that great name, demons have to flee. They must flee. Darkness has to scarper in and at the name of Jesus. So hopefully we'll have more of those joint songs where we all come together as a choir in the future. So I hope you enjoy that. And I hope you enjoy the service. If you need support or you need to be ministered to, either in prayer or you just want to speak to somebody, you can email us at communitychurchdeal.co.uk. Our website is communitychurchdeal.org, where you can see all about us and what we have going on here in this wonderful seaside town in the south of Kent. So please do get in touch if you've got prayer requests, etc. We usually have weekly sessions at the moment online where we've been teaching on prayer. And recently we've just finished warfare. And I know we will be teaching on deliverance as well and other topics. And as I said before, our associate pastor, Paul Hislop, is going to be taking us into a teaching on Christ in me, which is all about our identity in him and who he says we are. So lots of exciting things coming up here at Community Church Deal. Hope you've enjoyed the service. If you're not from this church, you've just been listening online, I hope you were blessed by today and that you visit us again. And of course, when everything's opened up and we're allowed to come together, you are welcome to visit us here in Deal in Kent. My name's Nick Gilchrist. It's been wonderful to be with you. And I'll see you next week. Bye-bye.